Hi everyone, welcome back to Brunei Creation Workshop. My name is Milan, and now we are learning English in VOA, learning English with reading a story named Love of Life by Jack London, Part 2. Continue right today. Now, let's start. He had no fight that night, nor hot weather. He put his blanket around him to sleep the broken sleep hunger. The snow became a cold rain. He awakened many times to feel it falling on his upturned face. Day came. It was a gray day with no chance. It had ceased raining. The sharpness of his hunger had departed. There was two pain in his stomach, but it did not trouble him so much. He grew more in control of himself, and once again he swore in the letter in the land the little sticks and the cash by the river disease. The snow had melted under the rain, and only the hilltops showed white. The sun appeared, and he succeeded in locating the way he had been traveling, but now he knew that he was lost. Perhaps he had wandered too far to the left. He now turned to the right to return to his true course. Although her hunger pains were not as great as they had been, he realized that his were weak. His were fought to bow for frequent rest. As Jotham, he ate the manga berries and grasses. His hunger felt dry and large, and it tasted bitter in his mouth. He had troubled him very much when he had traveled a few miles. It could be in pounding, then it could leap in a series of bits that made him feel faint. In the middle of the day, he found two small fish in a large pool. It was impossible to empty it, but his work came now and he managed to get them. It was no bigger than his little finger, but now he was not particularly hungry. The new pain in his stomach had been growing duller. It almost seemed that his stomach was slim. He ate the fish with great care. The eating was an act of poor reason. Although he had no desire to eat, he knew that he must eat to live. In the evening, he caught three more small fish, eating two and shaving the chest for breakfast. The sun had dried the wet plants, and he was able to build a fire. He had not traveled more than 10 miles that day. Another night passed, and in the morning, being more reasonable, he untied the little string that held the moose skin bag from its open mouth. mouse pulled a yellow strip of gold that he divided the gold into two equal parts. One half wrapped in a piece of blanket. He heads among a large formation of rocks. The other half he returned to his bag. He also began to yield strip of the one remaining blankets for his feet. He still kept his gun because there were catches in that catch by the river Dis. He ate them greedily, putting them alive into his mouth and crushing them like ashes between his teeth. The mother moth flew about him with cries of anger. He used his gun as a club with which to hit her, but she flew, made his reach. He threw stones at her and by chance broke away. She then runs away, dragging the broken wing with him following her. The little bird had now satisfied his hunger. He stumbled along on his barefoot ankle, throwing stones and screaming loudly at them. As other thumbs, he struggled along silently, picking himself up patiently when he fell, or rubbing his eyes with his hand when fainting threatened to overpower him. The bus led him across some wet ground in the bottom of the valley. He discovered footprints in the wet grasses. They was not his own. He could see that they must be bears. But he could not stop because the mother birds were running ahead. He would catch her first. Then he would return and examine the footprint. He tired the mother bird, but he tired himself also. She lay down her side, breathing heavily. He lay down his side a dozen feet away, unable to move toward her. And as he recovered his recovery, she flew by reach as his hungry hands stretched out to catch her. The hunt started again. Night darkened and chase escaped. He fell because of a witness cutting his way. He did not move for a long time. Then he rolled on his side. He won his watch and lay there until morning. He scored another great day. Half of his last blankets had been used to foot rubbing. He failed to find Bill's trail again. It was not important. His hunger drove him on. He wondered if Bill too was lost. By the middle of the day, the weight of his back became too great. Again, he divided the gold. This time, barely pouring half of its on the ground. In the afternoon, he threw away the rest of this. There remained now only the half of the blankets, the tin container, and the gun. A hallucination began to trouble him. He felt certain that one cartridge remained. It was in his gun and he had not seen it. However, he knew all the time that the gun was empty, but the hallucination continued. He felt it for hours. Then he opened his gun, angrily, only to find nothing inside. He struck ahead for half an hour when the hallucinations arose again. Again he fought it, and still it continued to give him relief. He again opened the gun and found it empty. At home, his mind wandered even further, but these moments away from reality was brief, because always the pace of hunger forced him to return. Once as his mind was wandering, it would return to reality by a chance, thus almost caught him to fate. Before him stood a horse. He could not believe his eyes. A thick cloud were in his eyes, flashes which boiled a blood. He rubbed his eyes fiercely to clear his sight. Then he saw before him not a horse, but a great brown bear. The animal was studying him curiously. Thank you for listening and see you again.